invited to say a few things. The only reason I'm here is because I just finished reading the book last week, Running with the Kenyans. It's one of the best books on running I've seen. It's highly recommended. It's great fun. And I thought I'd just share one little bit which I read from the book. It's written by a guy who's himself a very good runner, Mr. Finn. He went to Kenya to try and find out what made the Kenyans such great runners, and he also joined training camps with the who's who out there. So in this one page, he's talking to he's talking to one of the coaches, and he wants to interview some of the top Kenyan runners, and he asks his coach that, you know, I want the telephone number of Vincent Kipsang, who's a guy who ran the fastest marathon ever. He's the guy who ran the Boston Marathon in 2:03:40. And that was not counted as a world record because the Boston course doesn't qualify for being a world record course. So he asks for this number, and he gets a particular number. He dials the number and says, "Hello, Mr. Kipsang." This guy said, "Yeah, hi." He says, "I got your number from so-and-so," and then the other end, there is a bit of hesitation. So he says, "Aren't you Mr. Kipsang who did 2:03:40? And this guy says, "No, I did 2:05. You've got a wrong number. You've got somebody else. Now, Sam said, I hope that explains what Kenya is all about. Over to you.
Okay, hi everyone. Thanks for coming here. Hope you had a nice breakfast and a nice run, those of you who ran today morning. So basically, even I read the book Running with the Kenyans. I absolutely loved it. So, and ever since then, I think I read it last year, and ever since then I've always wanted to come here. I mean, go to Kenya and experience, you know, the life of a Kenyan runner. I think I have experienced, let's say, maybe half the life of a Kenyan runner. I mean, I did 200 kilometers in 2 weeks, but they do the same in 1 week, at almost double the speed. So actually, it would be 1/4 the life of a Kenyan runner. And these 2 weeks, two and a half weeks, were the most exciting, at the same time, most humbling experience of my life. I'll explain why in the presentation. So basically how I got there, I asked, there is this camp called the High Altitude Training Center in Kenya, which is where the who's who of athletics all over the world turn up to train. So I asked the owner of the camp, Peter, can I come over? I want to stay for a couple of weeks. So he said the camp is full. So then, I really persuaded him. I expressed my desire. I said, I really want to do it, and I absolutely love running. So he said, there are bookings till 2016. But I said, I really want to do it. So he said, okay, fine. I have found you a place. Why don't you come over? So I thought, this was a sign that I really have to go, and there is absolutely nothing left to stop me. So I landed up at Nairobi. So at Nairobi, you go through immigration. So there, that immigration officer asked me, so what have you come to Kenya for? So I said, I've come here to run. So he had a puzzled look. He said, you're from India. I said, yeah, I'm from India. So he said, then why have you come to run? So I said, I want to train with the Kenyan athletes. So he said, you want to train like a Kenyan? So I said, yeah, I really want to do it. So he had a blank expression, and he told me, you will never beat them. He gave me a 3-month visa, and he said, go train. So this is like, so basically the training camp is in a small town called Aitil. This is about an 8-9 hour journey from Nairobi. So you either do it by car, or you take a flight to Eldoret, and then around 1.5 hours you reach Aitil. So basically I landed at Eldoret Airport the same evening, and I drove over to Iten. So this is what happens after reaching Iten. I entered the high altitude training center. I mean, it has the who's who of athletics stay at the high altitude training center. On the left, this is how my room looked. This was my room. And this was the entrance, and that is how the room looked. It's a very simple room, basically perfect for training. All you do is eat, run, and sleep. Yeah. So this is at the high altitude training center. So the high altitude training center is run by Lorna Kiplagat, who's I think the world record holder in 5 kilometers and 10 miles. She and her husband Peter, they own the place and run the place. I mean, she was the like most Kenyan athlete. She was born in a farming family, and her training unofficially started while she was herding sheep and cattle.
Peter's an African.
Lorna was a Kenyan citizen, born in Kenya. Then she became a citizen of the Netherlands.
So Peter is?
Peter is a guy from Netherlands citizen, yeah. So she is now a citizen of Netherlands, but she's one of the few who have come back. So most the top Kenyan athletes usually go out for races, win big money, and I mean usually stay outside, don't usually come back to the country. She is one of the few who came back just to give something back. So the camp was originally for young female athletes from underprivileged communities who want to train in athletics.
Indians.
Huh?
Indians.
Indians.
But then it later became a camp which attracted the best long distance athletes in the world. They also house some amateurs like, So this is just a brief, this is how the pool looks as soon as you enter. This is the entrance to the camp. So it is just a small board on the side of the road. Once you enter, this is the small library to greet you. And here is the pool, and there is a lounge where people generally relax after their runs. Next. So everyone at the camp are awesome runners. When I first went there, I felt a bit lost because every person who wasn't part of a large group, I used to go and ask him, hey, okay, I used to get chatty with him, and then he used to say, yeah, I'm trying to sub a 2:30 for a full, or trying to sub a 2:25 for a full. And there was a huge contingent from Britain, apparently, who was training for the Commonwealth Games. So you hardly meet anyone who's not a great runner. So let me give you this example. I used to see this really petite woman in the cafeteria quite often. So, and I thought, okay, she was a pretty good runner. Next couple of days, Competitor magazine was doing a piece on her. She apparently lost the Boston Marathon by 2 seconds and came second. So if she'd have won, she would have become the only American to win the Boston Marathon. I mean, only first American woman to win the Boston Marathon. Desiree Linden. So basically, in short, and there was also an athlete called Reed. So he didn't look really, tough or like a Kenyan runner. He really didn't look like one. He was apparently he's the fastest Canadian runner. Currently, and I think also ever. And he's trying to sub 2:10 for a marathon. So they talk about running the Rio de Janeiro Olympics. Like, you're going for your next race at, say, the TCS 10K or something like that. It's no big deal for them. Basically, everyone here has their own Wikipedia page and their own International Athletics Federation.
When you say this is a high-altitude training center,
yeah.
What is the height of this town from the sea level?
8,500 feet. So this is me before my first run with the Kenyans. So I didn't know what to expect. I woke up at 6 in the morning. It was quite chilly there, just like the weather is just like Bangalore, The chilly in the morning and pretty hot in the evening, during the day. So I walked out. So
So basically my house is, I mean my room is down this road. So I walked out and saw a couple of Kenyan athletes here. So I thought, okay, let me join them. So basically at first I wanted to take a photo because I didn't know if I would survive the whole run. So these guys are extremely friendly. They are always willing to take on, I mean, let new people join in their runs. And usually they gather, basically you have a main road and there are many villages to the side. So it's about 2 kilometers on the main road. So just walking or jogging from the main, from their villages to the main road is sort of their warm up. They meet around, they meet up there, chat up for a while, and then go for their run. So it was supposed to be an easy 50-minute run. And I mean, since my coach here, Dharam, has brought me down to close to a 40-minute 10K, I thought maybe I could keep up. But I was completely mistaken. So the initial pace was just this much. I thought, okay, that's quite easy. But slowly it became this much. And then it became much faster. It was just 50 minutes. But they increased the pace very gradually and sort of you couldn't even feel it. And I was absolutely panting at the end. Because they had increased the pace from, say, a 7-minute kilometer to a 4:15 or 4 per kilometer. I mean, I could manage the same place back in Bangalore. I could manage doing the same thing, breathing through my nose. But here, I had to really pant and breathe through my mouth. It was, I don't think it was only the altitude, but you're always doing hills. I mean, it's rolling hills. And some places, the hills are quite steep. And as you can see, the surface also is not too even, it's very uneven. So it was a really, really difficult run. Because it was my first run in Kenya, I found it extremely difficult to do it. I mean, these guys are a really great bunch of guys, great people to run with.
You didn't take time to acclimatize or anything?
No, I just went out on the first day. Second day. No, 50 minutes, I think we would have done around 8 to 8 and a half. They don't use GPS watches at all. So when they say, we are going to do 8K in 50 minutes, they do exactly 8K in 50 minutes. No, they have a timer, but no GPS, nothing. They know the speed in their head. They know exactly what speed they're going at. So these are the famous mud trails and items. So here you see from the center, you see quite a few trails that just lead out from the, from the main road. You see a lot of these small trails that diverge out from the main road.
Did you run with a lot of bare feet runners?
No. There are no bare feet runners in Kenya.
No.
And I don't know if this it is a small observation. None of them have hair on their legs. I mean, the guys, or even the girls. No hair on their legs. I think either they shave it off, or I didn't find a single Kenyan runner with hair on their legs. I don't know why. And none of them run bare feet. There is no.
Did you also, in your package, was it also with the trainer, or it was just you staying there for the accommodation and the use of the premises? What you do there is up to you.
Yeah, that's what it was.
Alternately, they also offered.
So he
just went like that. I mean, just say, I'll go stay and come.
Yeah, so I was apparently the only Indian to ever train at the HITC. Since it opened about 9 years ago.
Do you have a Wikipedia page now?
I don't think Indians qualify over there. So anyway, I spoke to...
Is there a training program or anything? Is it just informal way you just enter?
No, he actually ended with a Polish coach.
So I spoke to the owner of the camp, Peter. So what he told me was... we got chatting, we got quite friendly.
Very good.
Yeah, I'll just go on.
That's good.
pills.
No, just audio flash pills.
Does it say audio?
Yeah,
it's better. Later. Maybe you can get out and just play the video if you have it separate instead of waiting.
No, there are other audios where Akinian is talking about his diet and all that stuff.
Okay, anyway. So I got chatting with Peter and he was quite friendly with me actually. Then, so he said, you know, why don't you organize a, I mean, why don't you be our representative from India? I said, okay, fine, no problem. So I said, you know, there are so many enthusiastic runners out here and it would really be great. So if I could do that. So he said, yeah, why don't you do that? So we have, there is a package, I mean, you can, there's one with one with a coach called Richard Mukche. He's a 215, I think, former 215 marathoner, now turned coach. So there they give you a 2-week training program. I mean, you have a safari included, massages and, sightseeing, lot of things. So that is one. The other thing is, you land up there and you figure out what to do. And that's what I did. I landed up there. I was very lucky because after the first couple of days, when there were only professional athletes there, a large gang from Poland turned up, around 13, 14 people from Poland. I joined up with them, so they had a coach, and I basically followed their training program for 2 weeks, and I was really lucky in actually having even met them. Our next. So this is the view you get while running. I mean, this is an example of this. These are small farms, and these are a couple of the guys I was training with. This is sort of the view that you get while you are running. You have a really beautiful view. I mean, green fields, growing corn. There are small kids, you know, who usually run up to you and say, "Hey, how are you? How are you? How are you?" And they actually follow you for the run, and it's quite impressive. They run.
And they beat you also.
Usually, yes.
So, kids race.
This is a small kids race which was organized close by. It's a kids race somewhere.
How many kilometers?
I mean, I don't think, at least whatever I've experienced for 2.5 weeks there, I don't think these guys were born runners. The Kenyans are, actually, most of the good runners come from the small tribe called the Kalenjin tribe. I don't think they were also born runners. I mean, if they were, they didn't have to do 200 kilometers each week. Or, they train at altitude, they train through hills, always it's up and down, up and down. And the surface is also uneven. So you'll actually, all the muscles in your legs actually involuntarily get strengthened. I was speaking to Lorna the other day. She told me that, so I told her this, I think these guys weren't born. He said, yeah, it's perfectly true. There were a couple of US scientists who came a few months ago wanting to take samples for DNA testing from her. So she found it absolutely ridiculous. She told them, we are so good because we train like crazy, not because there is some small gene in our body that makes us, unbelievable endurance athletes. Next. So now comes one of the best things I saw in Kenya. This is the entrance to the running track. So that's a school.
The entrance to the track of the gate, and here, how many athletes are?
So that is, I mean, that track is where all the magic happens, you know. The sweat and maybe tears of Mo Farah, Wilson Kipsang, Paula Radcliffe, say Abel Kirui, all the local Kenyan athletes has fallen on that, the mud in that track.
But is that a mud track? They have actually a proper track, no?
No, that is the track they train on. Every athlete trains on that track.
Doesn't HABC have its one of the few proper tracks?
No, so last week, actually, last to last week when I was there, they opened a proper track, the synthetic track like it's there in Kandiva Stadium. So they that was the first ever track of that kind in India.
That's a separate one beside this.
Yeah, but nobody ever trains there. Most of the people train here.
So Finn talks about this in his book, right? The steeplechases in Kenya train without a pit and water. They just train on mud.
Yeah.
And the only time they see water is when they get out of the continent. So. Basically, they don't have a... So they just train on the same track. 3,000 meters steeplechase runners also train the same track.
Simulation.
No, it's not simulation, it's just no facilities. They don't really care. They just run sub 4 minute miles.
I don't think they have an option.
Yeah. It's basically they don't have an option.
So here is a Kenyan warm up. That is Renato Kinova, Florence Kiplagat's coach.
Kiwi.
Kipsang.
Yeah.
Also.
Yeah.
Hello.
They're walking it. So 90% of the people who come here are Kenyans?
Huh?
90% of the people who train here are Kenyans?
Yeah, yeah, so they are from the villages close by. So then running, you know, it's like a storm. You know, you see, this is the, you know, the quiet before the storm. And now you slowly you hear the footsteps. And then you see all the mud thrown in the air and real thud, thud, thud. This is how they train, you know, this is a warm-up, but it's a group of about 30 people.
So how long does this run? How many times a day?
So this they do once a week, around 10 into 1K or 12 into 800, followed by 6 into 400 and then some 200.
It's like interval.
Interval, yeah. It's an interval. How about next? So this is then during the hard session.
What are the children?
I think someone in the background is.
Are there like coaches who are on the side who are shouting?
No, not too many have coaches. They just go as a group. Oh, okay. Yeah. They usually have a leader of the group and that person dictates the workout usually.
So it's just the only coach who are kind of chairing?
Yeah. I mean, quite a few foreigners also came there. People from Europe, US, they were.
Some of these guys land Mumbai
now. Upper next.
John
Kelly. So, you know, this was absolutely amazing. This was before a short race, which I saw at Elveret, the half marathon. And this is how it goes. Out of 600 athletes, 200 are equally capable of winning, or 200 people.
Take how many got?
Equally capable of winning the race. This was one of the weekend races which happened at
Elveret. So the athletes need to be
one. So the winner of this race won it in 62 minutes and 49 seconds. And the route was extremely bad, you know, it was not an ideal route for a half marathon. There was a bottleneck in which around only 6 people could go through. But there were about 50 people wanting to go through at the same time. So So it was extremely competitive and it was absolutely awesome to watch, you know. I mean, you will not forget if you really witness this race. And so after around 1 or 10 minutes, the race is unofficially over. You know, people start walking on the road, and even if athletes tell you to move, you know, people are least bothered. They are just walking like this. You know, you're anyway not going to win, so. So that's how good these guys are. So this is a short video of me running with the Kenyans.
Short.
The video was short because I could run only. See, I kept up with them for 200 meters. But they were doing a 10 into 800. So 200 out of that I could keep up.
When they do 10 into 800, do they do like 800 fast, 800 slow, or they just rest and do another 800 fast?
The rest is only about 30 seconds to a minute.
And then
they go again.
He's getting
ammo, man, to have a single throw.
So no money for him.
800 fast.
Yeah, next. So this is a short safari that I went to in Kenya.
Is that close to your place?
So there's nothing like heart rate monitoring and all, nothing?
They are least bothered. They have a stopwatch. That's about it. Yeah. So as soon as they finish the 800 meters, you hear, you know, beep, 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 beep. And then after about 30 seconds, you again hear a beep and they are off. So, you know, this was at the equator, you know, equator crossing. And that was...
This is close to Eldoret?
This is around 5 hours from Eldoret.
From I-10?
From I-10 it's about 4 hours. So these guys, I mean, I trained with these guys. So you see, Hakuna Matata is usually people say it there because everything, basically to put it, nicely, everything happens at a relaxed pace over there, you know, in general. So if people say, I'm turning up at 6, they turn up at, you know, 6:30, 6:45. But if a runner says, I'm turning up at 10, at sharp 10, he's going to be there. I mean, they do not compromise on that. But for everything else, time is flexible.
How much are kind of ordinary people running around there, or is it like restricted to like the athletes?
There are no, you know, people running for fun. I mean, they find it. You're running for fun, so you're an athlete. So I told them, you know, I run for fun. And I said, they were surprised. What does that mean? I said, you know, just recreational runner. Again, they were really surprised. I said, I really couldn't say too much because there is no such thing as a what they call a hobby jogger or recreational runner over there.
Probably they will come to Bangalore next.
Yeah.
Experience that.
Yeah.
Or we'll go there and slow them down.
They say, who are these?
So this was a large Polish gang who I met there. I was really lucky to meet.
Are there any people who are not running?
Yeah.
Most of them running.
So the athletes, so if there are runners, they are professional athletes. That's all they do, you know. They run, say, 6 in the morning, then rest, run at 10 in the morning, rest, run at 4 in the evening, rest. That's about all they do.
3 runs a day?
3 runs a day, yeah. Usually the 10 o'clock one is the hard one, and 6 o'clock is just, you know, warm up the muscles, and 4 o'clock also is an easy run.
What's the time?
So
yeah. What's the daily schedule? 6 o'clock, how long?
10 o'clock,
how long?
Yeah, so I'll get a Kenyan to tell you that instead of me telling you.
Let's say the previous one happened.
Who the speaks of the... Yeah, so the previous picture, I mean, that is a large Polish gang who was lucky to meet there. I mean, I did all my runs with them, and they were also, they were amateurs, they were just out there to have a good time. So I was really lucky to meet them, and I trained their coach, and it was, I mean, really, really fun, I mean, hanging out. No fun. I mean, dining hall, it doesn't look very great, but this is where all the most of the magic, lot of the magic happened to me. You know, so in the first few days, I didn't know too many people, you know, I didn't know anyone, I was alone. So I used to just sit down and eat. I mean, I didn't like to just join a large gang just randomly. I just sit alone and eat. One day this guy came up to me and said, "Can I join?" I said, "Yeah, sure." So he joined, and we got chatting. Apparently he was from Algeria. So I used to see him, you know, he was a very stylish guy, and you know, used to wear really fashionable clothes and everything. I think, okay, this guy's a big, you know, stud sort of guy, you know. I got chatting with him, he said, "Oh, you're from India. You play cow, India?" So he didn't know too much English. So he used to, you know, whatever broken English he used to. He was fascinated that we pray to cows, you know, because he used to eat them. So we got chatting, and he was again, you know, really surprised that we don't eat any meat, and he didn't know the concept of a vegetarian. So we talked for quite a while. So I said, you know, I'm just here for fun. He said, "Oh yeah, that's good, that's good." So he asked me about my training. I said, "Yeah, so I'm training with these guys." He said, "Oh, okay, that's nice." So I asked him about his training, and he said he was injured for a while, but now he's slowly recovering. After about 1.5 hours, I was just curious. I didn't even ask him his name. So I asked him, "Hey, okay, what's your name?" He did not too much English. So also, he'd tell me his name. He showed it to me on his Facebook, on his mobile. So it was Taufik McLoofy, the 1500 meter Olympic gold medalist. So anyone you meet there is that good a runner, and that he was extremely friendly, you know. He was asking me about my training. I mean, what does he care about? But he was, that was a really, really, really good one. And we spoke for about 1.5 hours, you know, after, you know, all the food was over and the dining hall was once it was closing, only we left. So he actually also, about previous slide. So he joined us for the safari, and that is him too. He's very open and very, very friendly guy. Next. So this is a lounge in which, you know, people relax after their runs. One day I was just sitting, and Paula Radcliffe and Mo Farah just walk in. And they sit down, and people don't really bother, you know. They're going about their business. And some of these British athletes were actually shouting at Paula, saying, You are using the Wi-Fi on 3 devices, and we are hardly able to get the Wi-Fi on 1 device. So that's how friendly these guys are. They're really nice guys. And next. The Wi-Fi is quite poor there. This pause once again.
In the world, I
So he's an athlete. So one day I went for a longish run around 24K, and I was extremely exhausted, so I wanted a deep tissue massage. So I just I met some Brazilian guy out there, so he told me, you know, these guys, there's one guy here, he gives really good massages. So I told him, okay, why don't you give me a massage. So he gave me a massage. So for about an hour and 15 minutes after that, you know, he told me, so I asked him, okay, do you run? He said, "Yeah, I run. I am an athlete. I am a professional athlete." And even while giving the massage, you know, he was laughing and saying, "Yes, yes, you are an athlete. All athletes have always pain all over their legs." Because I was screaming in pain for most of the deep tissue massage. Turns out that he was the winner of the Milan Marathon and a 2:09 marathon. And he was giving me a massage. This is his brother. He's also an athlete. I think a 2:15 marathon.
Yes. Okay. That is 10 kilometers.
Okay.
Then after that, 9 that. Mm. And then I go for another 20 kilometers.
Okay.
That is faster. More than it was. And per 1K is 320 or 325.
Okay.
yeah? That's our key. Then after that, after I rest, then on Tuesday I go to track. Maybe it will depend. Maybe I'll do something like 1,000 times 10. Or I can do something like pyramid of 800 to 400. Can you understand that?
Yes.
Yeah, it will depend what I did last week. If you like, this week I went to that 5 kilometers. So I must now go to, I must open my leg now with 400, that is 15 or 20 in Tuesday. On Wednesday I must go to 50 kilometers as usual. In the morning, 10 kilometers. After 9:30, I go for 20 kilometers. So in all week, I cover.
That day
I go for another. No, that day I'm going for forest for 19.7 hilly work.
Okay.
Yeah, kilometers. Then on Friday I go to him to. Yeah, that's what our program is mainly doing. On Saturday we go we finish in the morning, we go for 20 kilometers in the morning, and we rest. On Sunday we go for longer, it will depend maybe 13, 25 or 30 kilometers. Yeah, that's all our program is. In average, in all week, it's average of 200 kilometers.
200 kilometers?
200, that's all. The endurance and that determination.
And exercises or something?
Exercises after 20 kilometers, 19.7 or 18. After that, we do some exercises for 10 to 20.
Stretching?
Yeah, stretch.
What about core exercises or something like that?
Core exercise, where is that? Look for a special day for exercise.
But when do you do?
Okay, on Saturday mostly.
Saturday?
Yeah.
And the other, like, upper body exercises for arms?
For arms?
So they don't do too much core exercises, strengthening, nothing. They only run. That's all they do, mostly. So this is the entire camp.
What was the average age of athletes in this camp?
So I was one of the younger ones there. I think it's around between 24 and 40. It's a large range, but.
Continuation, next one?
No, it's a good
one.
What do you normally eat for breakfast, lunch, dinner?
Breakfast, we normally take tea, that is, milk and water and tea, sugar of course. Then after that, in the morning, and normally eat tea with chapati. Yeah, you know chapati?
Yeah.
Okay, and that is all after evening time. Last time we take actually ukali with mana, or sukuma or cabbage. Maybe sometimes you can take lunch in rice, but it's not necessary for rice. Rice, you know, like Tuesday, of course, the program is not that much, but hard, yeah. And the night, we take milk and ukali and, of course, skuma or, yeah.
Skuma means?
Meat. I'm called skuma meat.
Skuma means?
Skuma is another language, actually. Another mboka. You know that it's like actually Monaco. It's a different variety.
Okay.
Yeah.
Monaco, what is Monaco?
Monaco.
Yeah. What is that?
That is actually ravages, and vegetables.
Ah, okay.
Yeah, Indian skuma. in the Vatican. So, yeah. And what else?
And so what time, how much, what do you do? So morning is 6 to 6 o'clock run.
Yeah, 6 is...
So it will get over by 7 o'clock.
Yeah, it is by 7 sharp, we have already done good 13 kilometers.
After that, what do you do?
After that, we come at 30, and we rest that day, and that, we start another 20 kilometers. That's all.
So that goes till 11:30?
Yeah, that is called 11, not 11:30, 11 sharp.
And then you...
After that, we finish, we just come at sharp, then we prepare a lunch. Then after that, we take your lunch time. Then we sleep until 4 o'clock. We go for it. If it is smells that there is easy that day. We go for easy.
Easy.
Easy chalk. If it is supposed to be, it is not necessary, but if the work is there, you must attempt.
Yeah,
that's all.
So sometimes, some days you run 3 days. I mean, three times a day.
Yeah, like Tuesday or Wednesday.
Three times a day.
Or Thursday, yeah.
Easy and then come back, prepare tea.
Work feel, then 50, then feel, then if.
Yeah. And then you prepare tea.
Yeah, you must prepare tea because of your relax, your muscles, very good. That's all.
And then prepare dinner.
Yeah, then dinner.
And then sleep. And Sunday?
Sunday we normally rest. Everybody has, like me, I'm not running. I feed our mama, our family. I feed our school, my family, family members. You know, Sunday we normally rest. Yeah.
Okay.
That's all.
So diet is basically lot of ugali, lot of vegetables, and they drink chai about 4-5 times a day. And it's a very, very sweet chai. They put a lot of brown sugar usually.
What is ugali?
Ugali is maize flour and water. That's it.
So they don't have meat?
They do some
meat. Yeah, the ones who can afford it have.
Yeah.
I mean, these guys are not extremely rich. They're, I wouldn't say poor, they are not well off, certainly. So usually, you know, they are, I mean, from farming families. So you are, usually the tradition is that once you go, I mean, before you leave, you give your shoes. Or maybe some old, your running clothes. So, I mean, even I did that. And me along with that Polish gang, we sponsored a race, actually. A 3,000 meter race. The winner, I think, was 8 minutes 22 seconds. And we gave away the prize money and shoes and clothes and everything.
So what kind of push, like I see everybody runs to win or something like that, right there?
So during the race, they are extremely competitive and they are really focused. You know, during the runs, you know, they chat more and everything. But the race is how they earn a living. You know, they are professional athletes. Race only gives them money.
So there are so many people pushing and it's very hard for them to kind of win and all. So what kind of push they see, like, is a kind of mental pressure on them, or just take it like?
I mean, I don't think they are bothered about that. They're just bothered about finishing the race in a good time. And I think some of them start really fast. You know, the really good guys obviously start fast. But even the ones who are not that great also start along with them. So at least in the start, there is a lot of pushing and shoving, and at least one or two people, I mean, fall off. It happened. We conducted, you know, 3 races. And in each race, about one or two people fell. But, I mean, that is part of the race. You really can't do too much about it. But, yeah.
What kind of questions?
So this is just the people I met. This is Wilson Kixang, the world record holder.
So does he come for every program that they do there? No.
Yeah. So, how about go to the first, right? First. Oh, go back to the one. Yeah, so he has a group. You know, there is usually a marathon group, there is a middle distance group, there's around a 10K group. There's a group of about 25-30 people. They do the same, I mean, usually the same workouts every week. So So they sort of coach themselves. Maybe one or two of them have a coach.
Okay.
And around, I would say 70% have sponsors. I mean, they are sponsored by Nike or Adidas. And some of them go abroad to race, but while others, you know, want to go abroad to race.
So you were in the 10K group or half marathon?
I didn't join any group, you know. I went to this Polish gang, since they are also amateurs. Some of them I could keep up with. I mean, even if you say amateurs, some of them are 240 marathoners. So I don't keep up with them. The others, you know, they are just like us. I just ran along with them for every run. The Kenyans, I used to do so he mentioned the evening 4 o'clock run. So most of the evening 4 o'clock runs I did with the Kenyans. And when they do easy, usually the 10 o'clock one is not all that easy. But the 4 o'clock one, when they say easy, it's very easy. You know, they go at something like this pace. They don't go faster than that. It's around 5 to 5:30. And to them, that would be extremely easy. This is Paula Radcliffe. I mean, she was mentoring some of the British athletes there.
So, which is the next race that she's targeting? Did you talk to her?
Yeah, she said.
At least she has.
She said next year she would like to end her career as a marathon.
She's a veteran now, 40 plus.
She's 40.
Doesn't she still work there?
Renato Canova, the coach. One of the most famous coaches.
So these coaches who are like Renato, they come in and go out, or they spend a lot of time around the year?
So Renato is now, I think, now he is coaching the, there's a large Chinese contingent. Chinese national team is also turned up.
He's been appointed by the Chinese.
Yeah.
He's officially the Chinese.
Oh, okay.
Considering for long distance.
Okay.
So apparently the Chinese are coming in a group of 80 next year to this camp to train.
So at this point they're not very protective, the our secrets are getting out or something like that.
The Kenyans. I mean, they know, right? They know that there is no secret. So if you train as much as they do, probably there's a good chance that you could also come to their level. They don't mind at all if you join them for any run. Extremely friendly guys. Now they'll invite you to the next run and say, please come along. And so when you say, I wouldn't be able to keep up, they'll say, hey, no, you can keep up, we'll help you. And they're very nice, very nice people.
I think they do this to demotivate us. You don't see them.
300 kilometers, how many people in the world can keep up for 20? It's very easy for them to say, come along.
I get it.
You get that.
And 30-second break, remember, 800 meters, 30-second break. You will die by the third or fourth, you will pass.
And this is the topic. And the guy on the right also is a really good runner from Australia. Okay. So these are some of the people I met there. You know, the staff below is the kitchen staff. So they used to prepare specific vegetarian meals only for me. So everyone else used to eat, meat, but they used to. They were very friendly guys, very nice people.
Do they run as well?
So you either run and you don't run. There is no middle ground. So this is the sign that you see once you enter Iten. Welcome to Iten, home of champions. Yeah, so, I mean, me and Peter he's sort of asked me to be his representative from India.